again, and welcome to Winning with the Wrangler at Dick Powell's Leadership Corner, brought to you by Earth, Wind, Fire, Water Training and Development, where our passion is building leaders of today and tomorrow. Leaders, I have to tell you that this week has been a fun week. We're coming down to the end of the school year, and it was funny that I was talking to some people who work with college graduates and employers. I was doing some inquiring with employers on what college graduates need to bring to the table, and it was pretty interesting that the answers we started to get. So I'm going to share them with you, because I believe that this is something we as leaders need to think about. You see, today a discussion was had about whether or not a higher education prepared one for the workforce in the real world. Now, I was amazed when I returned home to pick up the newspaper and read an article that displayed and backed my opinion. That's pretty unusual if you usually think about it. Now, the article went on to ask employers what they felt was missing in the educational process in preparing graduates for employment. I think you're going to be amazed, but here are what the employer's responses were to the college graduate's lack of interpersonal skills. They said the college graduates didn't know how to speak with people or speak with one another. They didn't know how to communicate in an effective opportunity. Interpersonal skills. They didn't know how to build friendships or relationships. Second thing, they said leadership. They said college graduates had little to no leadership, either personal or corporate. They just didn't even know what the words meant, some of them. And so they asked them questions like, had you ever been involved in sports or Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts or some kind of leadership opportunity? They found that the majority of them had not been involved. Teamwork. They found that even when they assigned teamwork to groups of college people, and now that they were graduates, that they didn't understand how to do that. They really believed it was all for me and no for anyone else. You see, they didn't understand that all for one, one for all situation. Project management. They found that college graduates had a hard time even managing their own personal life, much less any kind of organizational opportunities. Math. Now, I struggle with math myself, but you know, I've had to improve over the years. But it was found that even their math skills were on a low situation, and when they talked about math and finances, the majority had a hard time keeping track of money coming in, money going out, and where it went. Oral communication. Being able to speak with one another or speak in front of a group, the folks here, the people we're hiring, found that this was a drawback to hire brand new education prepared graduates. Oral communication. Written communication. They found that the people from college graduates depended so much on their laptops or their computers to do spell check and spell correction that they didn't know how to do this on their own. Where to put a comma, where to put a dash, or what became, you know, abbreviated or highlighted. They just didn't even know. They depended on a program in the computer to do it. They found that college graduates had a hard time with creative thinking. And we went and did some research on that. We found creative thinking was normally drummed out of young people by the time they hit second or third grade, when they were told to sit down and be quiet and don't think on their own. We'll tell you what to think. College graduates, on the other hand, got there and said, well, gee, no one wants to really hear what I have to say, so they never even tried it. Employers found that college graduates struggled with research and analysis. They seemed to know where to go find it on the internet and how to look it up, but they couldn't go through the analysis part to find what was good, what was not good, or how to put it into their daily lives. Now, that was a pretty scary thought when the people told me that. And here here's one that I thought was really astounding. They found that the college graduates that were coming to them were not prepared for computer and technical skills. I found that crazy. I know all through their educational life in college, they had to use the computer in order to get by. Most of their books are on the computer. Most of their papers were written on the computer. It's not like the old days when we had to write them by longhand or type them on that old thing called a typewriter. You see, there were so many things that the people, the hiring folks, I can't tell you, the employers just kind of blew me away. Interpersonal skills, leadership, teamwork, project management, math, oral communication, written communication, creative thinking, research and analysis, computer and technical skills. I was amazed. I'm still amazed that we turned out college graduates and that's where they were lacking. You see, I found this is a most interesting set of facts. I've been saying this for the last 20 years or so, and it seemed no one has been listening. If these are the actual facts, then why are we, an educated society, not teaching these seemingly lost skills? That bothers me a lot. Now, I'm going to tell you that I was lucky. I was fortunate. I was a Boy Scout and learned how to use every one of those lost skills through that program. Teamwork is taught as soon as you entered through the door, your very first meeting. It's called a patrol meeting. And you belong to patrol and it's a team. Leadership. Leadership is learned through the use and study of the interpersonal skills that come along with the 12 points of the Scout Law. Oral and written communications. Well, they're learned while being a part of that patrol and learning to be a scribe or taking care of the finances. Now, my love for creative thinking came on from how to find my way in the woods and build a fire with flint and steel and how to find and prepare food for the team, the patrol. You see, we planned a camp out while first researching and analyzing the needs of the patrol using the project management to complete the planning. If one did not do their part, possibly no one had a tent or part of their dinner. We found this over and over, and it was a lot of fun, but it was an easy way to put it to work. I realized that math would be used as a way of building a budget, staying within the budget, saving for a rainy day. The computer and technical skill, of course, came along as I went into a higher position in the troop. They were just coming around about then, and skills and advancement of the patrol members were tracked. You see, to be a good senior patrol leader, you would have to not only display each and every one of those lost skills, you would have to prove them in action. Not just in theory, but also teach them to others. The experiential teacher learning process was a big part of scouting. Why we don't use that in our normal education system, well, I just don't know, and I've asked that question many times. The question remains this: how do we teach not only academia, we also include the lost skills and common sense? So where do graduates acquire these missing or lost skills? You know, that's a real good question. Now, fortunately, our company, Earth, Wind, Fire, Water Training and Development, we were designed to fill that gap between academia and the real world. You see, we here at Earth, Wind, Fire, Water Training and Development, our company, that is that bridge between academia and the real world life. Every day we encounter employers looking for customers, looking for clients, and we have client and customer skills. We work with people who are looking how to speak on the phone. It amazes me. People don't know how to speak on the phone. We teach them. It's good. We teach them how to write a simple order. follow an opportunity, be on time, dress appropriately, and use the academic knowledge that they have gained to be productive within the corporate society that they have chosen to be in. It just amazes me that these things aren't taught. I thought they were, but I found out they weren't. But I'm proud to say that my company, our company, that Miss Robin and I have, this is the one way we help companies and organizations and even churches work with their leadership opportunities and their leadership people. But when you read in a paper that the new college graduates in coming to the workforce are not prepared, that should tell someone at the college levels that we're just not doing a very good job. When I was the director of education in a large organization, I always felt that it was my job to ensure that when people came to a training opportunity, an instructional opportunity, that when they left, they would need little to no supervision or managerial oversight. And when they had no need for that, it was amazing how much easier it made for the teams to work together when they got out in the real world. I guess I'm not understanding why our colleges are not doing the same. Interpersonal skills, leadership, teamwork, project management, math, oral communication, written communication, creative thinking, research and analysis, computer and technical skills. We're not doing it. We need to do better. Leaders, it's our responsibility to make it happen. And it really is our responsibility to make it so. Now, this next section, I got a big kick out of it because you came to me when a person came to me and said, "Hey, Dick, I've been chosen to be a leader. Now what?" And I'm afraid I did exactly that. I started to give a chuckle. He said, "They chose me. Now what?" I said, "Okay, let's take a look at it. They chose you for a reason. They evidently saw something in you that they believe in. And here's what you need to ask them for. Hey, I'm going to need some kind of fast start orientation of what you want me to do and be in charge of. I'm going to lead it, but I need some help here to find out what I'm supposed to do. I need a job description. And with that, who do I report to?" You see, accountability starts with me, but I have to know what I'm accountable for and to whom and to what. I need some expectations. Now, whenever we work with someone new in our corporation, our things, and this is what he was used to, we hand them a sheet of the job description and we discuss it, and then we go over the sheet of written expectations of what we expect of them. And then I always ask them, "Well, what do you expect of us? What do you expect of me?" And we write those down, and we talk about them and we agree to them. And those two pieces of paper, the job description and the expectations, we actually write our names on and sign them and date them. And we give each other a copy. So now the person that's working with me has a copy, and I know what to expect of them. They know what to expect of me. I understand what their job description is. It's not willy-nilly or what I told them or another person told them and somebody else told them, and it changed every 5 minutes. It was there in black and white. And he said, "Dick, they haven't given me those." I said, "Well, you're going to have to ask for them." I said, "Will they give you access to their practices and procedures?" He said, "I'm not sure they have any." I said, "Well, that might be one of your first things that you get to do." You see, without practices and procedures, people really have no idea what their boundaries are, what their guidelines are. And if they don't have access to it, well, then it's just no good at all. I was at a large organization here just a month or so ago, and I asked for their practices and procedures, and the person handed me a big volume book that hadn't been updated in 10 years. And so I threw it in the trash. They said, "Well, you can't throw it in the trash." I said, "Well, I just did. It's 10 years old, so what good is it?" Well, the lady who had written it had been there 20 years. She was very proud of the Practices and Procedures book, but she had never upkept it. Or kept it up? I don't know. Some kind of word. Think about it. If you don't have an ongoing way to make sure that that stays current, it's no good. But you need one. Anybody should have access to the Practices and Procedures. So if that person who is responsible for something has an accident, can't show up, isn't there, you can immediately go to the Practices and Procedures book and look it up. Find out how to do it. It should be explicit. It also should take and tell you who the number two is. Who else is required to know that? Who else is in that situation? Man, oh man, I tell you what, it just is so easy, but this poor young man, he's accepted a job in a leadership position in a corporation that there was no fast start orientation, there was no job description, there was no expectations, there was no practice procedures. And he called me and said, I think I've made a mistake. I said, do you want to come back and work here? He said, yeah, I think I do. I said, I can only pay you what I was paying you when you left, and I know you're making more money. He said, I'll see you on Monday. And that's the way we left it. What a terrible way and a poor thing to do to some person who had their hopes up, dreams up, for them to have to go home and do that. Fortunately, we're still friends and we're pretty good relationship. And I talked to his wife and I told her, I said, you know, as soon as we can afford to raise that salary to what he was going to make there, I will do it. I promise you that. And she said, look, as long as he comes home happy, like he does from your organization, and not like he was coming home from the other organization, I'll find to make the money work. You see, that's how important these things are. So leaders, if you're sitting out there and you don't have job descriptions for each and every one of your people, including yourself, you don't have any written expectations for every one of your people, including yourself, hey, how do you know you're meeting any of your goals or milestones? I just don't think you do. And I'm going to tell you what, if you get in a car accident or a plane goes down or something else happens and you're not there tomorrow and there's no practices and procedures, they just going to close the door? Or are they going to be able to continue on? That is huge, leaders. This next part, I'm going to be real upfront with you. And I'm going to take and say it just like I'm going to say it. Leaders, if your organization, business, church does not have a vision, a written vision of the future picture, a written mission of your purpose, your calling, a written strategy, a plan of a day-to-day operations on how you're going to live your mission to achieve your vision. If you don't have those things, you're not going to survive. You're really not going to survive, and you're going to go even quicker if everybody in the operations doesn't understand it and didn't have a buy-in into it. If you think you can just say it once, put it on top of your letterhead, paint it on the side of the wall, but never ever talk about it or discuss it again, you're going to die. Your world's going to crumble and go away. Boy, I'll bet you're just fuming out there hearing that, aren't you? It's the truth. This thing of fast start orientation, job description, expectations, access to practices and procedures, and understanding and having to buy in on the vision, mission, and strategy is one of the most important pieces that you can put into your organization. So, hey, they chose me, now what? Well, if you don't have any of those things, now what? They chose me, now what? So I ask, where's your place in the strategy and the plan? Where on the organizational chart do you fall? Who do you report to? Did they assign you an accountability mentor? You see, none of those things happened. I felt so far sorry for this young man. I hired him back. There was no question about it. I didn't have any problem doing it. I actually felt guilty because when he left, I was excited that he was taking something on and going farther that I could offer. And I was so excited that he learned all those things, and he knew that when he didn't have them in front of him and he asked and they weren't there, he knew he was in trouble. So they chose me. Now what? When I work with church leadership, this is a good one for me. Because normally any kind of nonprofit organization that's out around the country, they try to bring people in to fill spots in the organization. And so many times, let's just say that if the body is up and moving and can fog a mirror, they get the opportunity. Sometimes they don't actually put the best people for the best position in that job. Now, here's what I'm going to tell you, though. It still can work. It still can be positive. It can still make happen if there's some kind of fast start and orientation of letting the people know, this is where you're at, this is where we need to go, this is what they're part of, pieces. Here's your job description. Let me describe it to you and take some time and go over it with you. These are some expectations that we think go along with the job description. Here's some practices and procedures for you to take a look over and understand of where we're at and what we're doing. Oh, by the way, let me explain our vision to you, and I want you to put this somewhere prominent so every decision that you make is passed through our mission and vision. Oh, and by the way, here's our organizational chart, and this is where you fit in. This is who you're accountable to and for. And by the way, we're assigning a mentor to you so that you'll always have someone to go and bounce ideas off, to check in with, and they're going to check in with you to help you be accountable for all the parts and pieces. Now, let me tell you how important that is in a nonprofit organization. You see, nonprofits are different leaders. They don't have to be there. They can walk away at any time. They don't even have to give 2 weeks' notice. And why would they want to stick around when every time they turned around, they were given a new job, a different job, a different thing, and they never knew from one moment to the next what they were going to be doing, how they were going to be doing, and who they reported to? But even in a for-profit corporation or business, I have to tell you that, like this young fellow I was talking about, he had to make a decision. Do I want to stay someplace where I'm not happy, someplace where my job description seems to change on a verbal opportunity daily by different leaders within the organization, and when one speaks, I do that, and the other one speaks, says, well, I didn't tell you to do that, and the other one says, well, you know, gee, I told you to do this, and I never know where I go to. I never know what's expected of me because it changes from morning till the afternoon. There's no practices and procedures. Everybody just does whatever the heck they want to. And you know, one does it one way, one does it some other way, and nothing jives and no moves together. Vision, mission, strategy, are you kidding me? Well, there's no such thing. We just come in every morning and we're told what to do. Sit down, do this, be quiet, don't ask questions. You see, no organizational chart. It's just the owner walks through and dubs whoever he wants to or she wants to of that day to be in charge. There's nobody to go to ask any questions, to take and, you know, get mentored by. There's just no one there. They chose me. Now what? You see how this goes together, I hope, with this thing about new college graduates. Even the ones who are going to entrepreneurial thought process schooling, even the ones who are going to be business college graduates, I'm talking to them. I'm talking to you, leaders. I'm hoping you're getting an understanding that these things that they're going to need to struggle with, you're going to need to help. You're going to need to be able to put this into place, and you're going to need to be able to put it into place as they go through their learning opportunity. This thing of interpersonal skills and leadership and teamwork are going to become more and more important for everything that they do with you and your organization. Learning project management is more than just being at work. you have to project manage it your whole life. Your career is part of it, but your personal life is there also. Knowing how to have to financial opportunities is going to be huge. But this thing of oral communication and written communication as a downside of college graduates is going to hold them back as well as you. So you're going to have to work with them on that also. Leaders, this is going to become part of our normal part of working with the individuals as they come into our work opportunities and our work style. So like this young man who called me and said, "Hey, Dick, they chose me. Now what?" And he was struggling with all those different things that we had to work on together. He found, quite frankly, that he was going to probably go out and work for himself. He was putting together some pieces and parts to job descriptions and some expectations. He was actually putting together some practices and procedures on how he wanted his company to operate. He took a long time at putting together this whole thing of the vision, this future picture and mission, the purpose, the calling. And when we worked together on the strategy, the day-to-day plan, I found him searching for ways to move ahead quickly, but a way ahead that was going to always take him on the right path, which was different than what he'd done in the past. In the past, he just did whatever he thought was right the day that he thought the day was right. So everything was willy-nilly, and sometimes things happened and sometimes things didn't. But having that plan place, that strategy, that plan in place, helped him put together what he's calling his organizational chart, even though there's only a few people in his organization. The cool part about it was, is he wrote down all the parts and pieces that needed to be done and completed. And he called that his organizational chart, and he started putting names by who could do what, when, where, how. He did that by doing some research and also building relationships to find out really what each person he was bringing on board could do to their very best. What it was they were going to value and opportunity they were going to do best. Not what they wanted to do sometimes, but what they did best and could bring to the organization to build it and push it forward. It amazed me that he's taken a lot of these things that he's learned here at Earth, Wind, Fire, Water, Training Development and put to use in building his own company now that he has decided that that's where he wants to go and what he wants to do. He has a fast start orientation for each individual as they come in to give an overview of what the company looks like, to let them know about the vision and the mission and the strategy. He has a set of job descriptions for each person that's very clear as to what is it going to be expected and a list of expectations to go with them that they talk about and both sign and date, and each person retains a copy. He's worked hard on putting together practices and procedures. He understands that if someone isn't there, someone's going to have to do that other job that that person's not there, whether it's him or someone else in the organization, and they should be able to pick up the practices and procedures manual and go to work. Yeah, it might be a little struggle, but all the information will be there, the sign-ons, the sign-offs, the how-tos, and all the everything else. He's taken a lot of time to actually put that into place. Now, I talked to him the other day, and now he's going to do short videos to put with inside the practices and procedures so he can actually take and walk them through it in a good manner. Well, I hope you've enjoyed today's opportunity that we've talked about. They chose me, now what? And new college graduates in the workforce. Now, on behalf of myself, Dick Powell, and the whole Leadership Corner team, we want to say thank you for being a part of today's program. Our hope is that you've received a nugget of wisdom and guidance that will help you build your leadership ability. Now, if you have any questions or comments on today's program, don't hesitate. Send me an email at dick@leadershipwrangler.com, dick@leadershipwrangler.com. You want to set your very own appointment, go to our website, www.leadershipwrangler.com, and go ahead and just click on that little box and set your time with us. If it's burning desire and you need a question answered right now, give us a phone call, 727-422-1833, 727-422-1833. It's been my pleasure to be with you today. This has been Dick Powell, Leadership Wrangler, saying ride hard, ride fast.